your assistant professor here in environmental studies. And it's great. I'll introduce the panelists just before they speak individually. But it's really nice to have such a mix of academic panelists and practitioners. I think a big criticism, quite justly often, aimed at academic work on climate change is it doesn't necessarily connect that well to what people are doing in practice and policy. So it's nice to have a mix of people this morning. We have four presenters focusing on both climate policy in California and particularly some of the environmental justice implications of that policy. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce our speaker, Tracy Perkins, who is a PhD candidate here in sociology at UCSC. She's also affiliated with the Center for Collaborative Research for an Equitable California. And she's been doing work on environmental justice in California for many years. If you get a chance, check out her website. She's a photographer as well, a very accomplished photographer. And some of her photography work is on the same issues, environmental justice in San Joaquin, in the San Joaquin Valley. So welcome, Tracy. Matters elsewhere in the country, and because through AB 32
think that understanding some of the complex array of all of the different environmental groups that have engaged with this process helps us learn or anticipate problems that other states may have as they try to enact similar legislation. And I think it also helps us shed light on the continuing relationships between environmental justice groups and more mainstream environmental groups. So AB 32 does a couple different, well, it does a lot of things, but all of what it does are designed to reduce our greenhouse gas emissions levels to 1990 levels by 2020 and 80% below 1990 levels by 2050. So this is a fairly substantial policy. And it's had an interesting history of how it got passed and where it is now. So some of the mainstream environmental groups, like the Environmental Defense Fund and the Natural Resources Council, are widely credited as being co-sponsors of this bill, though only legislators can officially be co-sponsors. And these groups reached out to environmental justice communities during the process of writing the bill for a couple of different reasons. One, because they're interested in equity issues to a certain extent, and environmental justice advocates are perceived as the kind of equity contingent within environmentalism. But also because there was a perception that environmental justice advocates could be a roadblock to passing this bill if it was not sufficiently to their liking by enlisting the support of the Latino caucus and other minority legislators to potentially block it. So you get, the environmentalists, the environmental justice folks, all the other key players working on this bill. And the environmental justice activists had a couple, saw a couple changes to the language of the bill that they claim as victories for their interests. First, they defeated a proposed mandated cap and trade mechanism. Actually, I'm sorry. They defeated a mandated market-based mechanism for controlling greenhouse gas emissions, which was assumed to be cap and trade, which was favored by Governor Schwarzenegger, Republican Party, Environmental Defense Fund, and Natural Resources Council. Instead, the legislation reads that California may use market-based mechanisms, but is not mandated to. So it kind of postponed the are we or are we not going to use market-based mechanisms till later in the debate. Environmental justice advocates also got included a lot of public health language in the bill. So passing our Global Warming Solutions Act is not supposed to have negative public health repercussions in vulnerable populations in the state. We'll talk in a minute about how that could conceivably happen. The bill directs the state to maximize co-benefits, which means that in reducing greenhouse gases, we're also meant to be reducing as much as is feasible other kinds of problems like health pollutants or air pollutions that have health implications with them. So a lot of this centers around the idea that although greenhouse gases don't have direct health threats, so to a certain extent, it doesn't matter where greenhouse gases are emitted. They're usually emitted with other kinds of co-pollutants, criteria air pollutants that do have health impacts. And we also know from studies that greenhouse gas emitting facilities are primarily concentrated in low-income communities of color. So cutting greenhouse gases has the potential to also cut air pollutants that the communities who live in those next to those facilities care a great deal about. And the bill also directs the state to maximize public and private investment in disadvantaged communities. So the legislation also did a few other sort of process-oriented things. It mandated an environmental justice advisory committee to weigh in and help the Air Resources Bill develop the scoping plan, which is sort of the official term for what's, I think, more easily understood as the implementation plan. And it also mandated public workshops for people who live in highly polluted communities to weigh in on the policy process. So these were some of the early sort of wins for the environmental justice community on this bill, but as soon as it was passed and went into the process of developing the scoping plan, lots of problems continued to bubble up. The Environmental Justice Advisory Committee felt very consistently that their input was being tokenized, that the Air Resources Board had already made its most important decisions about how it planned to implement the bill before actually hearing their input. So they were listened to but not, not responded to in a meaningful way. And so I wanted to speak a little bit more about some of the specific concerns that environmental justice advocates have about this bill. A number of them center around cap and trade as one of the key policy mechanisms among many that EB 32 proposes, and that the scoping plan that will implement it also proposes. So cap and trade is a concern for environmental justice advocates because it doesn't mandate on-site reductions in greenhouse gases, and therefore it doesn't reduce necessarily on-site the pollutants that go along with greenhouse gases that cause health problems. So this raises the possibility that there could be localized increases in air pollution. If, for example, a specific facility that's already in a low-income area decides, instead of cutting their own greenhouse gases, to purchase credits from elsewhere, and perhaps to expand over time. That's one possibility. Regardless of whether increases actually happen in specific communities, environmental justice advocates are also concerned that cap and trade denies their constituents the opportunity to reduce localized air pollutants that other options might ensure with across-the-board on-site reductions. So instead of a cap and trade plan, environmental justice advocates favor carbon fees mixed with direct regulation and some financial incentives. They also have a lot of concerns about cap and trade not having direct sort of democratic safeguards in that it takes some of the decision making about where greenhouse gas emissions will be reduced, puts them into the hands of the market. So localized community members that might be impacted don't have the opportunity to go to hearings and, you know, testify and sort of participate in some of these political processes that they're accustomed to being able to participate in the facilities that they live near. There's also some other concerns that they have about the bill. Again, specific elements of it, not the whole thing. There's lots in the bill that this group's favor. They have real concerns about the low carbon fuel standard specifically because they see a real potential for it to sort of increase the number of biofuel refineries in the state. And although these might be less polluting overall, they still pollute. And if you build them in areas like the Central Valley that, again, already have this disproportionate burden of air pollution, you raise the localized air pollution and sort of sacrifice potentially specific communities for the larger good. And these groups also have real concerns about international offsets. So the AB 32 has out-of-state offsets and some, I think, international offsets in Canada. But since then, Governor Schwarzenegger signed a memorandum of understanding with the governors of Chiapas, Mexico, and Acre, Brazil, that if it's fully implemented in California, would allow, again, California polluters to continue to emit their same level of greenhouse gas emissions by purchasing offsets in these other sites. So some of those concerns, again, are about, you know, not having on-site reductions here in California. And then some of them relate to a lot of the more international debates about offsets and the potential for abuses in those systems and the potential for folks living in rural parts of Chiapas and Mexico to be kicked off their land, essentially. So all of this culminated in a lawsuit. The environmental justice advocates lost a lot of the lawsuit, won some of it, eventually lost overall on the legal front, and we can talk more about that. But there's a couple points that I think are interesting to note about this particular case. One, and I think this is generic to many policy processes, but the environmental justice advocates, you know, they had they were able to mobilize their political power in the stage of writing the bill and passing it. But then once it got handed off into the Air Resources Board domain to write up how this bill will be enacted, their ability to influence that process decreased substantially. And then even after the fact, when they sued the Air Resources Board, they had very little opportunity, again, to influence it even through the legal process. As the judge determined that the state legislature had intended to give the Air Resources Board wide discretion in how to implement the bill. And so on almost every count, the judges deferred back to the Air Resources Board when they were responding to the advocacy legal challenges. One of the other points is that scale really matters. So it's possible to have a generalized environmental good that on some smaller scale actually is kind of an environmental bad in, you know, in this complex way. And those are things that have serious political repercussions for our policy environment. Participation is a double-edged sword. So environmental justice advocates have often put forth these ideals of participation in the policy process. They want to be involved, they want their voices heard, and yet they go through some of these official participation mechanisms and feel like, well, wait a minute, are we being tokenized? Are we being taken seriously? Is this just kind of wasting our time? And should we perhaps be, would we perhaps be better off, you know, not participating in this setting and, you know, doing some other kind of advocacy? And then finally, I just think it's important to remember too that climate justice problems and advocacy are not just a Global South issue, although I think we mostly talk about them in the Global South. And they're not just a, you know, across countries issue, but they have a million countries. And that also the environmental arena is often more complex than we think of it. Maybe that doesn't apply to the people in this room. But so you have environmental justice versus it mainstream environmental divisions. And then even within that, the cap and trade, we saw a fair amount of crossover. So the environmental justice advocates had support from a few, not many, mainstream environmental groups like the Sierra Club, and a whole slew of small and more radical environmental groups. And I think that in the face of, you know, the continuing problem of climate change and it's the way it's going to get serious, more and more serious over time, I think there's a real possibility for these tensions to not improve but get worse as the stakes get higher. Thank you.
Until after all our four speakers have a chance to talk. But we'll have about 20, 25 minutes for questions and discussion after this. So I'd like to move straight on to our next speaker, who is Michael Mendes, who is a PhD candidate in the Department of City and Regional Planning at UC Berkeley, and who works head of the Science and Technology, Medicine and Society Center and there at Berkeley. Before coming to Berkeley, he also had a lot of first-hand experience with the legislative process. He worked for the California State Legislature, and then most recently as legislative director for the UC Office of the President. And he's going to talk to us today about a case study about environmental justice in Oakland.
Would you mind if we all sat in the front row so we could actually see our counterparts' presentation?
Sure.
Great, thank you. Good morning. Again, my name is Michael Mendes. I'm a PhD student in the Department of City and Regional Planning at UC Berkeley. First off, I'd like to thank the chair and Professor Miller Ball, and also the conference is one of the panel organizers, Tiffany West, for organizing this great panel on localizing climate change, development, and impact. It's a great opportunity to be here to talk to both scholars and practitioners. The title of my presentation today is From Global to Local, the Civic Epistemologies of Urban Climate Change. This represents some of my initial findings from my fieldwork for my dissertation research. Typically, we think of climate change as a global issue that's often configured or constructed through international institutions such as the IPCC, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, where scientists, techno-scientific experts, and government officials convene to construct ideas of climate knowledge, climate science, through constructs of models, sophisticated models, to really get an idea of what's happening globally on climate change. So in recent decades, there has been really this shift to have a localization of climate change, moving from that global to the local. But often, as we know, these very complex models often don't translate to the local level, to the human level. Oftentimes, we're thinking of climate change as a global issue, as one climate, as one global mean average temperature. So what does that really mean at the local community level? My research specifically looks at the different meaning makings, the different diverse ways of knowing climate and configuring climates at the local level. How do environmental justice communities, specifically I look at the city of Oakland environmental justice communities and their climate action plans, how do they deal with these notions of climate change? How do they use their own diverse ways of knowing and local knowledge and expertise and data to really configure what climate action means at the local level? So typically, as we all know, the United States does not have a federal policy on climate, one federal national policy on climate change. And we didn't sign on to the Kyoto Protocol. But in the absence of those federal policies and international agreements, several states such as Washington, Oregon, New York, and of course, as we heard, California, are taking the lead in climate preparedness, adaptation, and mitigation. And as we heard earlier from Tracy, that California, again, is a global leader in terms of climate change mitigation adaptation through the enactment of AB 32, which was signed into law by then-Governor Arnold Schwarzenegger. And again, California is looked at as a global leader for subnational governments for climate change response and actions. However, we think of climate change or climate in California as being homogenous about how we interpret climate action. But the reality is, if you look more closely at the localized level and different climate actions and climate action plans throughout California, particularly in more politically conservative areas of California, such as the Central Valley, we don't all have the same climates. We configure climates in different ways in our different actions. If we look at the city of Fresno, they actually don't have a climate plan that they call a climate plan. They actually have a sustainability plan where they don't even mention or various human causes to climate change or degradation of the natural environment. Hence, I have this diagram here of an empty pie chart where they're not typically looking at greenhouse gas data. They're not creating an inventory, which is the typical instrument or inscription of tracking climate change. Another example is the suburban community of El Grove, which is outside the state capital of Sacramento. Here you had the city council establishing a technical advisory committee of experts and community members of deciding what are the goals, visions, plans, and policies that we really wanted to enact for the community of Elk Grove. However, when that technical advisory committee forwarded the recommendations and policy recommendations to the appointed body of the Planning Commission, these were actually also stricken out. Any references to human health and environmental justice were actually stricken out because they felt the terms were too political. So hence here, climate change does not include an environmental health issue. And then we also have another case in the Central Valley of Merced, where you had a very progressive thinking community in the Central Valley, perhaps because they're close to UC Merced, where the technical advisory committee and the city council were really being aggressive in terms of their climate action targets and goals, and they really did include healthy communities and environmental health. And they adopted a climate action plan in February of this year. However, with the changing political tides in June of 2012, a new city council came in that was more conservative, and they struck out all the previous language, visions and goals, and any references to human health and environmental health and climate change. And then you have the case of Oakland, which is my primary case study, where you had a very community convergence for climate change, where you had an environmental justice community coalescing around the Oakland Climate Action Coalition, which included EJ communities, social justice groups, unions, businesses, that really created a parallel process from a technical advisory committee or the city staff developing the climate action plan, where they really brought in their own local knowledge, they did their own data, they brought in their own expertise to really create a plan through a two-year process. So all these different cases, I claim, creates this configuring of different climates, these different epistemologies and localization pathways. Of course, the Oakland case would represent what I call a new climate society, where you have environmental health integrated with environmental equity, where these are scaled up from the local to more regional and statewide levels. And then you had the city of Fresno, which represents an inertia pathway where climate change is a non-local phenomenon. And then Elk Grove and Merced represents a status quo pathway where climate action conflicts with local values and culture. So my main case study, in my research, I do a multi-sided ethnography of the Oakland Climate Action Coalition, how they install local knowledge, environmental health, and their climate action plan, and how coalition members scale that up to regional agencies to include social vulnerability studies and issues in the Bay Conservation and Development Commission, and also including environmental health and EJ issues in the state legislature, the SB 535 and AB 1532, which were just signed into law, which deals with the cap and trade issue that Tracy spoke about earlier, and it allocates certain funding to actual localized sites and EJ communities. So again, I'm looking at the Oakland Climate Action Coalition in my main case study, and the coalition describes themselves as bringing together businesses, community groups, environmentalists, organized labor, youth, and everyday residents to create an equitable and just energy and climate action plan for the city of Oakland. So some of their guiding principles that the coalition did were, of course, to clean up air pollution, because the city's situated along the port, which is one of the largest ports in the state and the country. A lot of pollution comes from the port and the tanker trucks and the ships. They wanted to make sure that any action measures created green local jobs for local residents. They wanted to make sure any action measures actually save money for residents. And they wanted to improve overall environmental health for all community members. So I think what the Oakland Climate Action Coalition is doing is important, because our conventional view of science policy or climate policy is a linear, it represents a linear model where scientists, experts, techno-scientific experts, or in this case even planners, create facts about the environment away from society, away from politics, away from cultures and values. But in the case represents more of what I would call a co-productionist kind of framework, where I look at the idiom of co-production developed by Sheila Jasanoff in Harvard University and later adopted by Jason Corbett at UC Berkeley, that really acknowledges that co-production is viewed as emphasizing the contingency of expertise, and that neither professional nor lay knowledge can ultimately resolve uncertainty of science and technology. So co-production encourages the resolution through the introduction of more democratic processes and methods for professional engagement. So it really says that climate policy and science here is embedded in social practices. I also use the concept of civic epistemologies developed by Clark Miller at Arizona State University, which basically acknowledges the broad array of activities, social processes, informal practices, and institutionalized procedures by which people collect, aggregate, validate, and yield claims to knowledge about nature and society in public policy settings. So together with co-production and civic epistemologies, we have this really community convergence or public engagement with climate policy in the case of Oakland. Why is the case of Oakland important? I claim that the case of Oakland is important because it's really creating these type of ruptures in climate planning and policy, where EJ community groups are transforming techno-scientific practice in urban climate change and governance. Creating these ruptures are important because typically in urban environmental governance, usually knowledge again is made away from affected communities. So why are these ruptures in technical practice occurring? Because this community convergence in Oakland is occurring because we're going from this redefining of climate change from this global phenomenon to this local phenomenon. So localizing climate change is often faced with scientific uncertainty and debate. So many local governments are left with very few policies, professional norms, and technical practices to guide their efforts. So in the absence of these norms, social justice groups are localizing environmental health equity and urban climate change decisions and actions. EJ community groups are defining what urban climate change means and entails. And through the ECAP, help EJ groups in Oakland to transform the environment into an object that is comprehended, managed, and governed locally. So I'm going to briefly go over the five top transformative actions that the coalition included in the Climate Action Plan. I'm just going to briefly go over the successes and the wins, but I want to give the caveat that these were all sites of consultation, conflict, to include some of these action measures in the final adopted Climate Action Plan. The first win was to have the highest goals in the nation, where coalition members such as Bay, Localized, and the Pacific Institute provided scientific rationale that convinced the Oakland City Council to pass the highest greenhouse gas reduction target in the country, 36% by 2005 levels by 2020. This is more than double than what the California State Air Resources Board recommends, which is 15%. This is significant because the coalition knew that the higher the target, the more progressive and comprehensive the ECAP had to be, and hence the more opportunity you can include environmental health into the climate action plan. So they also convinced the City Council to adopt this by framing and bringing in their own data and expertise. They showed the main risks to Oakland, such as sea level rise and extreme heat. They provided their own mapping and data sets in terms of sea level rise and flooding. This shows that areas along the port and West Oakland, most of these are socially vulnerable communities, communities of color that would be most impacted by climate impacts. And again, they provided data on extreme heat days, heat waves. The second transformative win was really having this, again, community convergence and rally for climate change as an environmental health issue, where they brought in their own local knowledge. Out of the 150 action measures in the climate action plan, 50 are directly attributed to the coalition. And this is significant because, again, as I mentioned before, typically this is done, the climate action measure is done by technical advisory committees, not by directed by community members. And they're actually listed as one of the co-authors of the Climate Action Plan, which is a little unusual because typically they're not included on official government documents. And then third is social equity and climate action plans, making sure that any land use measures dealt with displacement and affordability. And then also adaptation. The adaptation plan, they really want to look at socially vulnerable communities. Typically, adaptation plans deal only with abstract notions of the environment and infrastructure. So here you had adaptation plans that dealt with human health and human communities. And again, looking at community resilience and ensuring that food justice issues, urban gardens were part of that local climate adaptation plans and greenhouse mitigation issues. And then fourth is energy democracy. The climate action plan called for establishment of community choice aggregation districts. Essentially, these are energy co-ops where the community would be in control of the local energy produced in the community. So this is thought of as an energy democratic process where the local community, again, controls some of the local renewables that are actually generated within the jurisdiction and providing local jobs as well. And this is thought as democratic because it provides an alternative to service provided by investor-owned utilities such as PG&E. And then finally, they looked at measures that made renewables more affordable for all communities, not just for the wealthy. And then fifth is also a holistic approach to climate action plans, having a really strong community engagement plan and process for climate change. Reaching out to other people that are not a problem, even though they were an environmental justice coalition, reaching out to the other diverse publics in Oakland, to youth, making sure that this was framed not just as about polar bears, as you can see from this graphic, but also about climate justice and youth. One example here is they hosted a solar-powered hip-hop concert at Laney College, where 35 Oakland residents installed an adaptation project, and they held other various workshops on disaster preparedness and low-income communities. So again, this represents the model for community engagement and climate action planning. So what are the next steps for the climate action plan? Well, the ECAP is still working on their adaptation plans and the resilience plans. They're still establishing policy standards, norms, and practices to carry out the CAP and to further define what urban climate change in Oakland means. And finally, why do we have this community convergence for climate action plan in Oakland? Well, it's because I argue that this really shows that this is how civil society actors in particular communities of color can really directly influence decision-making processes in California and throughout the nation and create this really strong community convergence. And it also represents how more scientifically legitimate and socially just decision-making related to urban climate change can be implemented. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael, and I'm sure there'll be lots of questions both on the specific papers and also the cross-cutting questions after we hear from four people. So next I'd like to introduce Ross Clark, who is the Climate Action Coordinator for the City of Santa Cruz. And he also works at, that's not a full-time job in its own, he also works at the Marine Labs at Ross Landing. He is I'm director of the Central Coast Wetlands Group, chair of the County Commission on the Environment, and I also think that congratulations are in order, because it's after, what, a 2 or 3 year gestation period, your 4 year gestation period, Ross's baby, the climate action plan for the city of Santa Cruz was finally adopted last week, Tuesday night, by City Council.
How's the sound? Can you hear me?
Yes, it's great.
All right, well, thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. This has been a great forum so far, and I look forward to hearing more of the discussions. And each presenter so far has really resonated with some of the things that we as a city staff and community have struggled with or strive to achieve through our climate action planning and adaptation planning. And we've succeeded a lot in having a climate action plan in place, but there's a lot to do still and a lot of learning we can do from our colleagues. So this is really a wonderful forum. We did get finally our climate action plan fully adopted, so it is a city plan, and from that it is actually part of the new general plan implementation of the new general plan. So there are environmental regulatory reasons for actually implementing it. So it gives us a little bit more of an ability to go to City Council and ask for the resources necessary to implement the plan and achieve the greenhouse gas reductions that we've identified. The primary City Council climate objective for the City of Santa Cruz is to reduce greenhouse gases 30% below 1990 levels by the year 2020 and 80% by the year 2050, and in addition to a number of other secondary climate goals, which are all integrated into the plan. The Climate Action Plan includes chapters on energy use in the built environment, how we intend to build more energy efficient housing and commercial buildings in the future through our green building program, and also how we hope to work with partners to increase the energy efficiency of our current building stock throughout the community. We also have a sustainable transportation and land use planning, because land use planning is the heart of the general plan. It also how we visualize our future development within the city leads to investments in infrastructure for transportation that can last for decades. And so having, making that link between sustainable transportation and land use development is really critical. And it's an area that we're just beginning to understand the full implications and how, looking to figure out how we're going to identify funding to achieve the goals. We also are going to continue with our great water conservation and waste management programs. We have a chapter on how we are we plan to invest more in renewable energy for our municipality and provide incentives and opportunities for the business community and residents to invest in renewable energy as well. Then we also have a chapter on local partnerships toward a sustainable community, how we partner with local environmental groups as well as the university, et cetera, on, and take advantage of the expertise and skill sets of those organizations to help us meet the greenhouse gas emission goals. Because a municipality in itself can only do so much, but through collaborations with TIFIDI and others, we have a much broader set of opportunities to help us meet those goals. And then as part of the plan, we actually have a schedule for implementation and how to track over time the success of our greenhouse gas emissions. Here's a table of greenhouse gas emissions inventories that we have done for the community of Santa Cruz for 1996, 2000, 2005, and 2008, and our projected required reductions by 2020. And you can see since 2000, we have been on a decline in emissions overall. And that those data really reflect a combination of our local citizenry's interest and investing and taking more conservation-oriented actions,
but also taking advantage of subsidies and opportunities like the swapping out light bulbs for compact fluorescents have really led to the reductions we've seen. And most of the reductions have been in energy efficiency in commercial and residential buildings. Transportation is going to be, for the long term, one of our biggest struggles. In addition to just completing our climate action plan, we've also, Santa Cruz is the first city in California to have a climate vulnerability and risk assessment and adaptation strategy that has been approved by City Council. And it's not the best document in the world, but it really helps outline how a local municipality goes through a process of educating its municipal staff and multiple departments on the future risks of climate change and how we can all work together to identify and prioritize actions to minimize those risks in the future. We focused on sea level rise, coastal storm damage, and precipitation and coastal inundation because we're a community that that surrounds a river mouth. The combination of increased rain events and sea level rise and storm events could lead to the most severe impacts on our community. And so some of those things are what we've identified within this plan, as well as potential impacts to economy as well as infrastructure. Some of the ways that we've identified we can adapt or respond to climate change. Here's a photo from the Pacific Institute of downtown Santa Cruz and the flood zone associated with the combination of river flows and higher sea level rise and storms. And you can see that much of our economic center or downtown or city hall, et cetera, is within that flood area. So we've identified mechanisms to address or adapt to climate change, including coastal retreat. The yellow line indicates where coastal erosion is most possible. We've looked at zoning and general plan amendment opportunities, shoreline protection, flooding and of roads and buildings, and how we prioritize moving or protecting those structures. We've identified some of the potential losses of infrastructure and services and that what that could mean during an emergency and how we would respond or adapt to that. And we've also identified how these issues could impact economic development as well as low-income housing, because much of the Beach Flats area, of course, is part of our low-income housing, and it is most vulnerable to coastal flooding and inundation. Zoning and general plan, land use planning, however, is something that we've identified needs to happen, but we as a local community neither jumped ahead and identified what that meant, nor do we feel that it is our ability to do that alone, and we're looking to regional and state partners to really identify what that means and where we go from here. From a general plan perspective, however, I use this picture to identify what we're facing as we move forward. A general plan is a 20-year document that outlines how we're gonna build and grow as a community, which is outlined in the blue square there. Here's sea level rise to present, and several of the different projected rates of sea level rise into the future. A 20-year span of a general plan could lead to a building being built in 15 or 18 years. An expected life of a building is 50 years. So you see where our policies that we're making today are leading to development that's going to be far into the future. And with the uncertainty of sea level rise and these other environmental changes, there's a significant uncertainty with how we are already approving development along our coastline. And that's something that we really need to start to understand as a community and as a region. One more minute. Here are some of the questions that I see we're going to need to talk about in the future. How do we manage development on a changing shoreline? How do we plan cost-effective protection strategies?
and a special establish appropriate retreat policies? How do we invest limited city resources to support a vibrant economy while dealing with these environmental threats? And also, something that's very important to me, how do we preserve natural habitats while responding to all these human threats as well? And then finally, what is our adaptive capacity as a city or a community when regions of Monterey Bay are even more vulnerable to climate change? What happens when the Pajaro and Salinas Valley become more permanently flooded and we lose some of our most valuable agricultural land? What does that lead? What are those implications on us as a local community? And how does that impact our adaptive capacity? Those are things we don't know, but are things that I think we all need to start talking about. Thank you.
Thank you. And finally, I'd like to introduce Lacey Rock, who is here at UC Santa Cruz, who is the new, I guess, new since April, right? And the new climate action manager at UCSC. She also had a very similar job to Ross in the city of Monterey. She wrote the city of Monterey's climate action plan, as well as the bicycle transportation plan, and managing the Safe Routes to School program. And I think we're also going to hear partly about your Fulbright work as a Fulbright scholar in Indonesia as well. So I look forward to that. Thank you, Lacey.
Hear me okay?
Yes.
That's okay. I only have one slide, and I'm going to wait to bring it up so that you're not distracted by it. Thank you for the introduction, and thank you for inviting me here today. It's a pleasure to speak to all of you. As Adam alluded to, I'm going to try to mix together some of these different roles that I've had in the last few years and talk a little bit about each. And I've made this chart and sort of put together what I see as some of the differences and connections between these different levels of governance. So my current position is working as Climate Action Manager and Interim Sustainability Director at UC Santa Cruz. Previous to that, I was working at the City of Monterey, writing their Climate Action Plan and various other plans. And before that, I was the Fulbright Scholar in Indonesia, where I looked at the National Sustainable Development Strategy that they had developed in response to the Rio Conference and Agenda 21, and how that plan was being implemented at a provincial and a local level. And what one of the questions that I like to sort of ask is, who leads this motivation? And for this chart, so I'm going to actually come around and talk a little bit about it and look at it with you. So what I've tried to identify are some of the key factors that influence change and progress related to sustainability and climate change. And those are listed across the top. There's citizens or students, there's the history and culture of that institution or that location. There are formal leaders, so whether it's a mayor or a chancellor or an executive committee that's dedicated to sustainability. There are NGOs, which was discussed and brought up quite eloquently, I thought, in the Oakland example of how NGOs can influence this process. There are businesses that are impacted and that can influence. And then there are also reporting systems, which hasn't been brought up yet today, but has been proven to be, I think, influential in different ways. So I'm going to talk through some of these, and I should sort of have the disclaimer that this isn't based on an academic study, or it hasn't been peer-reviewed. I'd actually be really interested to hear Ross's perception of how the city of Santa Cruz may differ in some of the, but it's just based on my experience and the communications that I've had
with these different stakeholders. So first I want to take a look at Indonesia. I'll start very broad and then sort of narrow it down. When you look, think about the citizens within Indonesia, I categorize this as being as the citizens having a low level of influence in decision making. And the reason for that, I think, is very historical in the sense that citizens in Indonesia don't feel a lot of empowerment that even if they want to make change or see areas in which they could make change, that they feel comfortable doing so. I think that is a result of the history of the country and the sort of militarization of a lot of the environmental and specifically forestry issues that they've experienced in their country. And there's also a strong level of corruption in Indonesia, and a lot of the citizens that I spoke with while there indicated that it wouldn't matter. You know, even if you could fight the big fight or fight the good fight, it wouldn't make a difference because corruption was so rampant and so much more effective than the citizen voice. And that relates also to history and culture. Those same reasons are why I categorize that as having a low level of influence. Formal leaders, I think this is, they have a medium level of influence. The president has made very broad statements about, you know, there'll be no tree cut down for the next 3 years, and there's policies that sort of got to that, but it doesn't happen in reality. It's a broad statement that is very visionary, but it doesn't trickle down and actually happen. NGOs, this is the only, Indonesia is the only sector where I categorize this as high. And this was based on in my experience, I was actually partnered with an NGO. They were sponsoring a lot of the work that I was doing. And I was based in the city of Balikpapan, which is on the island of Borneo. It's within the province of East Kalimantan. And it's the hub of a lot of the natural resource extraction that is coming out of Borneo. So it's a major port on the island, and anything that would be taken out legally would go through there. And the NGOs were really active there, and specifically international NGOs. So groups like World Wildlife Foundation, they would have a very strong presence in that area. Businesses had a low level of influence. I think what amount of influence they did have was more of a greenwashing influence. And businesses, large multinational corporations, sort of had stock pamphlets and questions about how the work that they were doing was actually contributing to social justice and giving people jobs and improving communities by building schools. That was something, sort of a disconnect that I saw. Recording systems, they had a level of influence, but it reminds me of a funny story that I experienced. They had a competition between reports that different cities in Indonesia put out based on sustainability. But the competition, who received the award, wasn't based on the work that was done and the results that were included in that report. It was based on how pretty and aesthetically pleasing the report was. So I actually laughed out loud when somebody told me that, and I think I might have offended them. And then moving on, the city of Monterey, sort of getting down to the next level. The one thing that you'll notice throughout these is, or throughout the city of Monterey, is I categorize most of these as medium. I didn't consciously do that or recognize that until after I'd gone through this process of categorizing these. And I was thinking about, wow, why are all of these medium? And
thank you.
And the reasoning behind some of that, I think, gets at the fact that each of these are sort of influenced by each other. So citizens influence the formal leaders can influence business, history, and culture, so they're very much interconnected. And I have 2 minutes, so I'm going to skim go through the rest of these pretty quickly. UCSC has the highest rating, I would argue. And I think part of the reason for that is that they have integrated sustainability at a deeper level. And part of that may also be because of the history and the tradition and the culture of the campus. But instead of going through all of these piece by piece, I want to just touch a little bit on the differences between these two in my last couple of minutes, or between these three in the last couple of minutes. And one of the things I've found is that I have found that citizens and students and history and culture can have the greatest impact. Particularly at UCSC, the student involvement is really second to none, and we're recognized throughout all of the other UC campuses and looked to as a model for student involvement in sustainability and climate change issues and the action that's taken on them. And I think about the process that has been defined by a woman who has done remarkable work in the field of institutionalizing sustainability. Her name is Leith Sharp, and she has this process where institutions go through this sort of awakening stage of understanding what is sustainability, what is climate change, what does this mean, what do I have to do, and then pioneering and leading maybe pilot projects and starting to set some ships sailing on the field of sustainability. And then you sort of hit a roadblock, and the institution sort of struggles with, how do I go deeper? You know, we've done lighting retrofits. We have a bicycle plan, and we have all of these things in place, but how do I really transform the actual nature of the institution in which I'm working? And I think that's what all of these different levels are trying to achieve in some capacity or another, with varying levels of success and varying different challenges. But I do think that's what's getting at the heart of the issue. And in my experience, out of these different places that I've worked, UCSC is sort of closest to identifying what that transformation means and looking very much internally at systems, at funding models, and my time is up. But I think this is a fascinating topic, and I'm really interested in hearing the discussion that's about to begin. Thank you.
And I also, I, also served as the vice chair for the Sacramento City Planning Commission with an adoption of their climate action plan. And then looking at the various field work I've done in other climate action plans, there really is this permissive attitude from the state and how do you achieve these greenhouse gas reductions? So that's why we see in the various cases here, the various sites of innovation or sites of conflict in terms of climate action plans of how we're going to do this. There are some levers, threats of lawsuits by the Attorney General that can really steer you towards one particular way, but in general, it's very permissive and very open-ended and a lot of uncertainty of how you actually achieve this. So that's why we see different variations of climate action plans throughout the state.
Change and whether you all have a different have a perspective on the extent to which it's useful, and it's part of California, is very unique compared to a different world out there. Thinking about climate change at the local level, is it, you know, you mentioned some differences in terms of Oakland being able to kind of move forward in a much more advanced way than some other cities that you've looked at, but I guess my question is whether there's an advantage of not talking directly about climate change and talking about what people are really concerned about at the local level, whether that is energy conservation, whether that is pollution, whether that is transportation and congestion, and kind of the relationship between climate change and climate change action and sustainability goals or healthy community goals, and what are the kind of strategies that you're seeing local communities, whether those are environmental justice groups or cities in pursuing their agenda in that landscape.
I don't know. Do you want to go first? I'm still sort of formulating.
Well, when we first set up right here after the presentation, I told her I really liked her matrix because I think that was a really good summary of, you know, how history cultural values really impact how we deal with climate change. And even in Oakland, that has a long history and culture of being environmental or sustainability leaders and having social justice groups, EJ groups, leading the path and having a sort of parallel process from the city in their public workshops, they really did have to have a really engaged community strategy, because it's just, the last slide I showed on the polar bears, not just about polar bears, is like how do you have, there's a really this connect of climate knowledge or science from local value and local fact or culture. And just educating the people, you first, not educate them, but really show how does this relate towards their environment, how does this relate to other environmental agendas or sustainability agendas? Because I think right now in terms of this globalized notion of climate change or climate change at the California statewide level, really disconnected community. So again, it's really having that connect of what is the local history, what is the culture, and how do you scale that up into a larger climate action agenda?
Yeah, I think that you change the message based on your audience, right, like anything. And I'm a Minnesotan, born and raised. I don't know if my accent came out of my presentation, but how I speak to people here about climate change and sustainability is very different than how I speak to people when I go back home, because there's, in California, I think a level of sophistication and understanding and acceptance that one, climate change is real, and that we need to act upon it. And something that's interesting in my work in Indonesia, when I would talk to people about these issues, when I would use the term sustainability, kind of glaze over, not know what sustainability was, but when I said climate change, oh yeah, okay, I know what that means. So.
For me, trying to engage the local business community, I think some from the environmental standpoint would accuse me of going too far into engaging them on the economic values of energy efficiency and engaging in the 21st century economy of, you know, green technology. But I think it's a reality. You have to speak to the interests of the group you're with. And climate change is unique as an environmental issue because it does incorporate a lot of different issues that different people are thinking about, and there is a strong economic justification for taking the actions we are.
Okay. talk about race and ethnicity. And so I wanted to ask you, Tracy, and also you, Michael, in terms of understanding community and breaking apart the sort of oftentimes what we characterize as a very homogeneous sort of notion of community, how, in terms of the discussion on climate change and issues identified by different sectors of a community, especially along issues of race and ethnicity and migration status, for instance, how do people's priorities or concerns about climate change vary so that, Michael, when you talk about this organizing effort in Oakland, that those things have to be sort of reconciled? Because I can't imagine that, you know, the Latino population in Oakland versus the African American population, they probably have sort of different priorities in thinking about how they respond to climate change or how they identify, you know, their most important agenda items.
So my research hasn't yet touched down on the local the way I think all of yours has, local climate plans, et cetera. I've been looking so far at a state level response to a state policy. Race and ethnicity comes up there in a lot of ways. I was thinking about Professor Eakin's, it was somebody who spoke already, was asking us to consider, I think it was you, how the institutions that could potentially be fixing these problems are understood and imagined. And certainly, low-income communities of color in California that sort of self-identify as part of the environmental justice movement do not necessarily see our environmental agencies as their protectors. They often find themselves in opposition to them, filing lawsuits against them on a variety of subjects. And they find themselves kind of continually bringing up race and finding that, you know, decades of doing so in some ways doesn't seem to be getting very far. So some of the research that I've read talks about climate change and environmental justice advocacy and how tired environmental justice advocates get of continually bringing up race as important, not only in how environmental problems and amenities are distributed, but also in terms of the leadership of the environmental movement, of the sort of cultural values in the room when people discuss these problems, et cetera. So I guess all I can really say is it continues to be a stumbling block. And environmental justice advocates seem to, in the policy process, continually find themselves being the one to say, wait a minute, greenhouse gas emitting industries are disproportionately located in our communities. That means that if cap and trade is pretty much the only thing in AB 32 that will affect, you know, industrial emissions, that we really care about that. So, for example, environmentalists, one of the sort of mainstream environmental critiques of the EJ lawsuit is, well, you know, cap and trade is only accounted for 20% of the emissions. The implication being, so why isn't that big of a deal? And so these communities say, yeah, actually, it's a really big deal for us. Circular answer to your question.
No, I think, Tracy, hit some good points, and I do believe that race, class, ethnicity, identity is central to a lot of EJ groups in terms of climate action plans. As I mentioned before, climate change is a very abstract notion, a very non-human notion. It doesn't look at the marginal communities, vulnerable communities, or the resilient communities within climate change, within different environments. And the EJ communities have a long history of looking at the disproportionate impacts from pollutants in industry and their neighborhoods, and they see that this momentum of climate change that's happening, abstract notions, or as Tracy mentioned, a mainstream, primarily wealthy or white environmentalist, is going forward. And many are seeing this as an opportunity of how do we link the two? How do we say that all these causes of all these human made causes to the environment are disproportionately impacting our communities, not just in terms of environmental justice, but as global and global climate issues. So I think they do see this central as an issue. They've seen it central environmental degradation, central issue for decades, as we all know, and that this is a new framing of how they can achieve justice.
Maybe I'll just add one more example too of this idea of environmental justice advocates sort of feeling like they're continually bringing race to the table and getting tired of always being kind of that person. So AB 32, you know, does direct funds in different ways to disadvantaged communities, and so they need a screening tool. You know, how are they going to pick which communities are these more recent conflicts is over the design of that screening tool. And environmental justice advocates put forth a model already developed by scholars, Manuel Pastor, Stanford professor, and his colleagues, that was built, you know, in collaboration with grassroots communities, and they sort of tested it all out. The scholars did all the scientific stuff, and they felt good about the screening tool. And the Air Resources Board chose not to use that screening tool, but to start a new one that doesn't have race as one of its, you know, indicators of how you would pick these communities. And so the advocates are again saying, look, we know it's not only class. We know that all race, you know, people of color, regardless of their class position, are also more likely to be in polluted communities. And sort of going through that continual process in the process is just an example.
One really quick question to finish with, and a question.
Sure. I mean, it's more of a comment, I think, than anything. I won't disagree with the fact that we should be putting climate in the center of our politics on this issue, particularly as it pertains to energy. So when I teach energy and the environment, talk about climate change for a little bit, but then I show them frac ponds, I show them mountaintop renewable sites, like showing the real extractive aspects of energy production. And the reason I think it's a little challenging to be putting climate in the center of politics is that it puts uncertainty into the center of politics. Whereas the impacts from energy extraction are real, they impact communities quite clearly and things like that. So I understand in terms of adaptation, it might be a different story, but I think I ended that, my opening talk in my energy environment class, with this comic that's showing this guy lecturing and saying green jobs, clean air, clean water. And two guys in the audience are kind of whispering to each other and saying, oh, wouldn't it be terrible if it's all a hoax and we create a better world for nothing? So I really think that we really should be thinking really clearly about the politics of this and how focusing on climate really makes us think about, or invites opportunities to incorporate uncertainty about what the impacts actually are when there actually are clear-cut impacts from energy.
Yeah, I'll just to build on that. I mean, one thing I see in the climate justice literature in the U.S., I'm sure you've seen too, is environmental justice advocates saying, hey, we've been all this time living next to these energy facilities, all this time trying to contain them, all this time trying to clean them up. How come we're not, like, being held up as climate change activists? And how come our solutions aren't being portrayed as, you know, wow, aren't these people doing great, you know, climate change work? And so I think some of them would really agree with you that that's one way forward, is to highlight what they've already been doing and to build on it.
And the last comment, I've seen it from the other end, where the green objectives around renewable portfolios, et cetera, have led to environmental degradation because we're choosing to put solar panels out in pristine desert habitats and then running cables through these areas. You know, when we have all these homes and these residential areas that should have solar on them. And so we're actually, in some ways, causing more environmental impacts because of our green policies.
Yep.
I'm not really optimistic, Lorraine. to wrap this up, thank panelists once again.